Today it's our pleasure to host Dr. James Barrymore in this history seminar. Dr. Barrymore will talk about Kosovo independence and institutional development. I understand that there is no much need to introduce James, who is a renowned expert on the Balkans and particularly on the Albanian question. He's the author of numerous books on Kosovo, Albania, Greece, Bulgaria, and Turkey. And among his books, I'll mention just a few that relate to Kosovo and to Albania. These are Kosovo Express and Expressi I Kosovës. It's both in English and in Albanian. The Albanian Question, Reshaping the Balkans. In Albanian, it's Qështja Shqiptare, Rekonsimi Ballkanit. Albania and Kosovo, Bugaj, and Albania, from Anarchy to a Balkan Identity. These books are all here. They will be available for those that would like to purchase them. And we'll all have the pleasure of taking these books with all this signature. I'm honored to give the floor to James. Constitute Skopje was fought over in much of the First World War, and what local state presence was there, I think would be fair to say, disintegrated. And so really, by the end of the First World War period, you had a non-functional state of an occupied country, an absent state of an occupied state. And this phenomenon of state absence, I think you can argue, has in many ways been a central theme, or one of the central themes, of Kosovo history throughout the 20th century. The problem has always been here, irrespective of the exact state and national boundaries or international presence or political organization, the form of a respected state, a respected form of governance that the majority of the people of Kosovo would be happy with or be better be pleased with. In the later period after the First World War, the first external governments to attempt this was Royalist Yugoslavia. The Royalist Yugoslav model down here, in my view, depended on colonization and the extension of the Serbian boundary, Banovina boundary, south towards Greece. One should bear in mind, without going into details in this paper, but one should bear in mind some detailed outcomes of the Second Balkan War in this context, where different countries were able to effectively grab different parts of the Italian Empire, which meant that the boundaries of the Royalist Banovina, the Royalist Ministry system, did not correspond to those of the Ottoman Empire. This further added to the subdivision of the Albanian majority people here between the nations. What picture do we get from local sources about the state and governance in the 1920s, the early Royalist period? I think it's fair to say that the original form of governance actually carried on a very direct inheritance from the Ottoman period, because it was almost entirely military. The Serbian army was going to date back to the former governments. One can see this in memoirs of the time, but also in new books, which are being published. I would commend to you my friend, Dr. Nada Boskovskis, at Zurich University, about the fate of Macedonia and the Royalist Yugoslavia. There are many similarities in what they were at in territory. But the basic picture is one where you had an external military administration that carried on, if you look even in the historical records of the buildings that were used in the St. Petrovitz, that carried on many of them in certainly the same buildings as the Ottomans had left behind. We then saw some developments, because the Yugoslav army and the king was very stretched. They didn't like police work. This was not especially appealing to the opposite class. The system of global rule depended on the central going to have an effective police force. Many other things were needed that were not provided. For instance, at that time, we have records from 1923 that show that Mitrovica had some of the worst public health problems recorded ever in Europe. Typhus, malaria, and mass outbreaks of tuberculosis, and many other illnesses, and the infant mortality was at a very, very high level. So, basic health